If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. Feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, oh, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you feel lost, I'm either way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh, if you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, well, he's a chain breaker.
How could I hide this joy? chasing down the meanings when every sign points a different way. Just a little bit faster, just a little more slow. Well, you're already past it, just a little ways to go. Now with a little more feeling and a little less flair, well, it'll work out, I swear.
Until I rise like the morning. Good morning, church. Good to see you this morning. I'm glad that you decided to come worship with us today. Good morning to those of you that are watching on Facebook this morning. Let's stand together. They're all looking at me going, but I just got sat down. Why not? Don't make me stand up again. Come on, let's stand together and let's sing some songs this morning. Let's worship our Lord today. He's worthy of praise, amen. He is worthy of honor. He is worthy of praise. So you lift your voice with us and let's sing.
Has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I had sought.
My prayer today is that something that is sung or something that is said today will cause you to want Jesus in your heart. It's important. It's important. Hey, I just want, Brother Ronnie's not here today, so I'm just going to make a couple of quick announcements, and we're going to keep worshiping and singing. Brother Eddie Garner's here. He's going to bring the word in just a few minutes, and it's going to be great. So I hope you're here ready to experience a blessing from God today. A couple of things. This afternoon at 4 o'clock will be our KOK graduation service. After the service this morning, I need help clearing the stage off. The piano and the keyboard can stay, but everything else has got to go. And then the risers have got to come out. So if you can just stick around for maybe 10 or 15 minutes and help us clear stuff off the stage after service this morning, I would really appreciate it. Also, let's not forget that coming up June the 2nd, all of our kids' stuff on Wednesday nights will be back open. And I think it's great what God is doing in our preschool area and in our children's area as we continue to pray for our leaders there as they continue to try to get things going again. It's kind of difficult with all the COVID stuff that we went through and having to shut down and then open back up and shut down. And it's difficult to get families reconnected with the church, especially families that have children. So pray for them. Pray that God will continue to make a way for them and lift them up in prayers as they continue to plan. This morning, we want to remember the Joan Hammond family in our prayers. I was asked to mention that specifically. Just ask God to do a work in that family. Anyone else have a request that's on your mind this morning that you just want to say, hey, Brother Keith, just as you pray and lift me up, I've got something going on in my life and I need a prayer. Anybody? Anybody got something going on? All right. Okay, I see those hands. Thank you. So let's have a word of prayer together, and we are going to continue to worship our Lord this morning. Father God, thank you for giving us this opportunity to worship you today. And Father, I'm not stupid. I know that Satan's been beating up on us all week. Some of us he's been beating on pretty bad. And Father, I know that there are families that are here today that have stuff going on, and they need a prayer. They need some encouragement today, Father, from you. So Lord, I just ask that you search us and know us this morning. And Father, if there's something going on in our lives that doesn't need to be there, I pray today you'll help. You'll just wash that stuff out of us. Father, for those families that are going through financial difficulties today, Father, I pray the God that owns 1,000 cattle on 1,000 hills, I pray, God, that everything, Father, you got it all. So, Father, I pray your blessings on them. Father, maybe there's other stuff going on in people's lives this morning, Father. Lord, I just ask that you do a work. I pray that as we continue our service this morning, God, that not only are you lifted up and exalted, Father, but we pray today that your Holy Spirit will have freedom to roam around and to do what he needs to do, Father, to encourage, Father, to lift up, to break chains, Father, to lift people out of, lift their feet out of the miry clay and set them on a rock, Father, so that they can enjoy who you are and be able to worship in you. Father, thank you that you sent Brother Eddie our way today to bring your word. Father, I thank you for him and his family, Lord, and I ask that you really bless him in his time to speak here in just a little bit, Lord. Give him the words that he needs to say. Father, today let us be able to say that it's been great to worship in the house of the Lord. And Father, we lift you up and ask that you do all these things in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. So turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, God is good. He is good.
Good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you. Endureth forever.
Lord, you are so good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Oh, come on.
People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you. We worship you.
and so good. Yes, you are, yes, you are, yes, you are.
Morning, we may have just scared you to death. Oh, I've been told more than once I got some black blood in me. I know I do. But hey, let me say this. If you are visiting with us this morning, we are so glad you're here. Congregation, join me in welcoming those that are visiting with us today. Thank you for being here and for worshiping with us. And if there's anything you need, please let us know. Now let me bring it out of the stratosphere. Down here to where us, you know, good old Southern Baptists can enjoy a little bit this morning. I don't know, just worshiping God does something to me, y'all. Because of what he's done in my life. He's done so much for me. Not only did he save me and break those chains of bondage and deliver me out of addictions. And I know I say all that and you're going, well, here's one of those other testimonies. Somebody was bad, now they're good. And I'm not like that. And that's great. Man, I'm so glad that you didn't have to go through all the things that I've had to go through in my life. But just because I'm a bad, or I did bad, and now I'm good, that doesn't mean you don't have, my wife is going to argue with me about that here in a little bit, but that doesn't mean you don't have a good testimony. You can have a testimony like this. I grew up in a loving Christian home. When I was 5, 6, 7 years old, God touched me and said, hey, I want you. I want you to give your life to me. And you gave your heart and your life to Jesus. I didn't go through all that stuff that you went through, Brother Keith, but God saved me. And boy, what a testimony that is. Isn't that a great testimony to have? I hope everybody in here, before we leave today, can raise their hand and say, God saved me. Amen. His blood cleansed me. His blood washed away my sin. His blood that flowed from Calvary forgave me and cleansed me and made me who I am today and can do the same thing for you today. So let's bring it on down. Let's just lift our hands and just worship the Lord and sing.
Oh, Thank you.
Your name, we've exalted you, we've lifted you up. Father, I pray for Brother Eddie as he opens your word for us. Father, you promise us in your word that it won't come back void when we speak it. So Father, I pray today with every word that's spoken that you'll anoint Brother Eddie to share exactly what he needs to share with us today. And may you be praised. Father, thank you for already blessing us. Father, we look forward to more. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. Thank you, Keith and worship team. I always enjoy worshiping with you. It's always a wonderful experience to be here. And I really appreciate Brother Ronnie's invitation to spend this morning with you while he's away at a conference. And I know the Lord is going to speak to him, and through the Lord speaking to him, he'll even be a better pastor to you in the days ahead. So thank you for allowing your pastor to do that, and thank you for allowing me to spend this time with you. I enjoy your pastor because he's a good tennis player, and we spend a lot of time on the tennis courts together. Some of the things that we say to each other between points, I'll keep that between us, but we do enjoy that. And he's also my racket supplier. If I ever have any racket, not that I would ever throw a racket or anything like that, but if my racket ever breaks, Ronnie has about 50 rackets at any given moment in the trunk of his car. And if you know him, you know that. So anytime I need a racket, I say, hey, Ronnie, I need a racket that looks like this. He says, you look in the back of my car. If it's there, he makes me a good deal on it. So anyway, thank you, Ronnie, for that. And thank you for who you are as a body of believers of being a part of the Colbert Lauderdale Baptist Association. I'm thankful for who you are and what you mean in our community and in this part of Lauderdale County. You are making a tremendous impact for the Lord. I did mention I like to play tennis. I am not a runner. I mean, I run on the tennis court, but I'm not a marathon runner or anything like that. But I read about this lady named Georgine Johnson, who was a runner. And she got to the starting line 15 minutes early for the race that she planned to run, and it cost her 20 miles and a pair of aching knees. You see, Georgine signed up to run in the Revco Cleveland 6.2-mile, 10-kilometer race. She got there 15 minutes early and heard a gun go off to start a race, and she started running. And she ran through downtown Cleveland about 4 miles, and then the race began to go along a path that she was not familiar with, and she began to get that sick feeling inside that maybe she was in the wrong race, because the marathon, the 26.2-mile race, started 15 minutes earlier. She got that feeling like, uh-oh, I'm in the wrong race, and she ran up beside a runner running in the race, and she said, "What race am I in?" And this guy looked at her like, "Lady, you must be crazy." And he said, "You're in the marathon." And she said, "I started crying." And then she looked in front of her, and there was a man wearing an old Nike t-shirt that had that phrase that Nike used, and it said, "Just do it." And so she said, "I just did it. I ran the marathon." The next day, they interviewed her, and they said, "Well, I guess I was in better shape than I thought I was because I was able to run the race. Got some sore knees, but I made it through the race." I don't know where you are in your spiritual life. This is a time of graduation. On the cover of your worship guide, there's a wonderful verse about pressing on graduates to receive the vision that the Lord has for them. I want to encourage you today. Maybe you're about to graduate from high school. Maybe you're about to graduate from college. Any graduates in here about to graduate? some of you, and some others of you are at a different place in your life where maybe you're graduating into retirement, or maybe you're graduating towards marriage, or a different adventure in your life. I want to challenge you this morning to be ready to just do it and take the next step that the Lord has for you. In the Old Testament book of Numbers, we find us two chapters, Numbers chapter 13 and Numbers chapter 14, where we see the children of Israel on the threshold of everything God had promised them. They had been wandering for 40 years in the wilderness, and they were on the threshold of entering the promised land in Numbers chapter 13 and 14. And Moses gathers together leaders from the 12 tribes of Israel and gets ready to send them into the promised land to come back with a report. I want you to read with me Numbers chapter 13. I'm going to read verses 1 through 3, and then I'm going to read verse 30. Numbers chapter 13, verses 1 through 3, and then verse 30. Notice the word of the Lord there. I'll be reading from the NIV. The Lord said to Moses, "Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the Israelites. From each ancestral tribe, send one of its leaders." So at the Lord's command, Moses sent them out from the desert of Paran. All of them were leaders of the Israelites. And then look at verse 30. Verse 30. Then Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, "We should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." Before Nike ever thought about just doing it, we see brave Caleb speaking up in the scripture and says, "We can do it." And so my challenge to you would be this morning, if God places a vision before you, God places an idea in your heart of how you need to step out in faith and follow Him, as you reach into the future, I want to challenge you to faithfully do it. The truth I would like you to take with you this morning from this passage is God rewards faithful followers with the promises of tomorrow. God rewards faithful followers with the promises of tomorrow. You see, the children of Israel were ready to take the promised land, but they had to be willing to step out and receive all the Lord had for them. So as a body of believers, maybe you're on the threshold of receiving everything God has for you, but you need to be bold enough and courageous enough to step out and receive it. Faithful followers indeed courageously step into the future. Notice verse 2 in chapter 13 that I've already read. He says, "Claim the land which I am giving you." He's already promising them the land. He's saying it's land that is yours if you will simply go out and receive it, to take the land and receive what is there for you. It takes me in my mind to John 3:16. You know that verse. "For God so loved the world that" what? "He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You and I have the opportunity to receive, as Keith has already shared about, that wonderful gift of salvation. That's part of receiving what the Lord has for you. John 1:12 says it like this, "But as many as received Him, to them He gave the power to become the children of God." This morning, have you received what the Lord has for you? You see, He says, "I want you to go out and scout out the land." Now, I want you to notice on down, we didn't read this, but in verse 6 and verse 8 of chapter 13, there are two leaders. There's Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and there's Hoshea, the son of Nun. That is Caleb and Joshua. We'll come to know these guys in just a moment because of their bravery and because of their courage. Moses gathers these leaders, and in verses 18 and following, he said, "I want you to go out and look in that land, and I want you to come back and tell me about it. I want you to tell me if the people there are strong." You notice that he said, "Are they strong or weak? Are few or many? What kind of land is it? Is it good land or bad land? Tell me about the trees. Are they fertile? Tell me about the crops. I want to know everything there is about that land." And then the last phrase of verse 20, he says, "Bring me some fruit. I want to know the fruit." You like fruit? I like fruit. And here Moses is saying, "Bring me back some fruit because I want to see what's in the land." And so they go out and they come back with a report. And that's where we find what happens here in verse 27 and 28. He says, "We went into the land which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here's the fruit. And then in verse 28, he says, but the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. And we even saw the descendants of Enoch there. They come back and they say, Moses, it is unbelievable. It's a land that's flowing with milk and honey. There's fruit everywhere. It's unbelievable. In verse 28, he says, but. Isn't that a three-letter word that haunts us in our walk with the Lord? Lord, I know you have great plans for our church. Lord, I know you have great plans for my marriage, great plans for my family, but we don't think we can do it. But we're hesitant to step out in faith. But there's giants over there, but we're afraid to step out in faith. You and I need to be careful that we don't allow that phrase, we can't do it, or but it's terrible over there. The people are so big that we'll be destroyed. We should not let that hinder us in our walk with the Lord. And that's where we see our friend Caleb in verse 30. He stands up. The scripture says he silenced the crowd. It was one of those moments where you could have heard a pin drop when he was courageous enough to stand up in the midst of that crowd and say, we can certainly do it. And I want to suggest to you this morning, we need people in this church and in all of our churches in this association to be Caleb kind of men, to stand up and say, whatever the vision is the Lord places before us, we can do it. As God gives us the strength and the vision and the idea, we step out in faith and say, we can claim what the Lord has for us. It reminds me of Philippians 4:13. What does it say in Philippians 4:13? I can do some things, all things, through Christ who gives me strength. So if the Lord gives you the vision, the Lord places the idea within your heart and within your spirit, the Holy Spirit speaks to you, be just as brave as Caleb and say, we can do it as God leads us, because God will give us the strength. At Earl Trent Assembly, our Baptist camp, many of you have been to Earl Trent, I know. We have a ropes course there. Has anybody here been on the ropes course at Earl Trent? Some of you may have been out there. You've seen it. You've been on the ropes course. Well, the ropes course has a zip line. It's about 40 feet up in the air, and you work your way through the ropes course. You climb up the climbing wall, and you get to the zip line. And you sit on this, they call it sitting on the log. You're sitting just on the piece of lumber that's holding you there. You've got a harness on, you're in a zip line, you're secure. But there comes that moment where they call it falling off the log. You've got to be willing to let go of everything secure that you think is secure and trust that zip line to carry you through the air. There are some people who have sat on that log for 15, 20 minutes, 30 minutes before they have actually fallen off and trusted it to hold them. I would tell you, a few guys have yelled words I can't tell you in church when they went off that log because it scared them to death. We got one on video. I said we need to erase that before anybody else sees that. It wasn't a preacher, I'll tell you that. But when he went off that log, because it scares them to death. And that's how it is in our walk of faith. Sometimes we've got to be willing to let go of everything that is secure and trust the Lord to lead us and to guide us. These 10 spies came back and said, there's no way we can do that. But there were two men who courageously said, we can do it. Joshua and Caleb, they said, we can go out there and take possession of the land. You know the Old Testament story of David and Goliath. It seemed impossible, didn't it? Until David hit Goliath right upside the head with that rock and knocked him dead. Sometimes you may feel like you're facing an impossible situation, but yet, friends, if God gives you the vision and he places the idea within your heart to step out in faith, you need to be courageous enough to step out in faith and claim what the Lord has for you. Would you be courageous enough to faithfully step into the future and claim what God has promised you? I don't know what it is within your heart, but if God's been moving in your heart and showing you something that you need to do in faith, I encourage you today to be a kind of believer that says, hey, I can do it because God is guiding me and leading me, and I will courageously step into the future. Faithful followers courageously step into the future. But on the other hand, God punishes those who doubt His guidance. That's the hard part of this passage. In verse 14, or chapter 14, we see that the Lord is heartbroken because these children of Israel will not be courageous enough to step out in faith. In verse 6 of chapter 14, Joshua and Caleb, they were brave enough, and they said, we can do that. But in verse 10, the whole assembly talked about stoning them because they were courageous. The glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all of the Israelites, and then the Lord and Moses have this conversation in verse 11 and 12. Notice what the Lord says to Moses. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the signs I have performed among them? The Lord and Moses have this conversation, and God says, how long until my people are courageous enough to trust me? God was heartbroken because the children of Israel were afraid to step out in faith. And I wonder sometimes if you and I are guilty of breaking God's heart because we are not willing to step out in faith and receive what He has for us. It broke His heart because they would not step out and receive the promise that God had for them. And you and I need to be careful that we don't break the heart of God because of our lack of obedience and our lack of faith and trust to step out and claim what He has for us. Now, God's judgment is no laughing matter. Look at verse 12 there, right after those verses. He says, I will strike them down with a plague, and I will destroy them, but I'll make you into a nation greater and stronger than they. God's judgment is no laughing matter. What He says to Moses is, He said, those guys who were not courageous enough to step out in faith, He says, they will never enter the promised land, and I will strike them down. It's a word of warning that you and I need to be careful that we follow God faithfully and do what He's challenged us to do. For years, before I was director of missions, I served as campus minister at UNA. Some of you were my students at UNA. It's good to see you this morning. Dr. Jack Moore was the dean of the School of Arts and Sciences, and he was our faculty advisor. So when we had to have checks signed for our ministry, I would go over on campus and see Dr. Moore. And one day, it was approaching graduation time, about this time of year, maybe a week or so ago before UNA's graduation, and I sat in his office, and he said, Eddie, do you know the hardest part of my job? And I said, what's that, Dr. Moore? He said, on the day of graduation, he said, I have to walk through the graduation line at rehearsal where a student thinks they're about to graduate and pull them out of the line. He said, I have to walk up and say, I'm sorry, your GPA is not what it needs to be. Your quality points are not there. Come on with me. You're not going to graduate. Think about how heartbreaking that would be. You've got family coming to celebrate with you. You've got a party planned. And there's Dr. Moore saying, sorry, you're not going to graduate. That's what I see right here in this passage. They were so excited about entering into the promised land, and those that did not have the faith, those who were not courageous enough to step out and receive what the Lord had for them, Moses said, sorry, guys, you're not going to be in the promised land because you didn't have the courage, you didn't have the faith to step out and follow God. The Lord punishes those who fail to follow His guidance. But He describes Caleb and Joshua. Notice in verses 24 and 30 here of chapter 14. In verse 24, He describes Caleb as a different kind of spirit and follows me, what does it say? In the NIV it says wholeheartedly. He follows me wholeheartedly. And then in verse 30, He mentions Joshua. No one of you will enter into the land I swore with uplifted hand to make your home except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun. These were men of a different spirit. I suggest to you, we need to be people of a different spirit. People that reflect the spirit of Christ in us with the courage to step out in faith and receive what the Lord has for us. Sometimes following the Lord is scary because He leads us onto a path and we don't see exactly where it's leading, but you and I need to be courageous enough to follow where He is leading and step out in faith. to know that He is the one that guides us and we can be firmly linked to Him. You know, as I think about this passage, that you and I need to make sure we're willing to follow His direction and follow His path for us. I have some grandchildren now that I love spending time with, and they love the little electric train that hooks together. And, you know, as playing with them, you can learn some valuable lessons just by watching children play. But I was watching my oldest grandson, Josiah, play with the train set, and I realized, and he realized, that if those train cars were not hooked up to the locomotive, those cars would never move. They needed to be hooked up good, and then he would turn it on, and they would all go together. But if one gets disconnected, it doesn't move, and it doesn't go. You and I need to make sure in our life, as we follow the Lord, that we are firmly linked to Him, and we are following His direction and His path and His guidance, and we will follow Him fully and completely. Because when we fail to follow Him, we get stuck on the track, and we're not moving in the direction that He would have us to move. What I see in this passage very clearly is that you and I need to be faithful followers, courageously stepping into the future with the courage to follow Him faithfully, even though we may not know exactly where it's going. But friends, if we're linked up to Him, the path will lead where He wants us to go, and we will follow the path that He wants us to be on. It's your time to just do it. I don't know what the Lord is saying to you. I don't know what path He is leading you on as you follow Him, as the Spirit leads and guides in your life. But I suggest to you this morning, why don't you just do it and step out in faith and follow Him? You see, I don't think you can be eternally blessed or productive without the presence of the Lord in your life. Let me say that again. I don't think you can be eternally blessed or productive or at peace without the presence of God in your life. This morning, Keith has shared already about the beauty of trusting Christ and walking with Him. You know, there's a short story called Maud Muller. I don't know if you've ever read that poem of Maud Muller. It was written by John Greenleaf Whittier. You didn't know you were coming to church this morning and get an English lesson. Don't worry, I'm not an English scholar. But I know the phrase in this poem, and I looked it up to read about it because it was very interesting to me. Maud Muller, in this poem that was written by John Greenleaf Whittier, he writes about a judge and an old country maid. The judge is very formal, and he has a black suit on, and he's riding a horse out through the countryside. And as he rides this horse out through the countryside, he crosses a creek. And at that creek, there is this beautiful maiden lady. And at the creek, they exchange a glance. A glance is all it was, as they gazed into each other's eyes. And as they went on, the judge rode on his horse off to the city. The maid stayed there in the country. The judge ended up marrying a lady from town who married him for his riches and for his status. The maid at the river creek, she married an old, uneducated farmer guy. And they spent the rest of their lives with the people they married. But they always thought about that moment at the creek where they exchanged that glance. And that's where the phrase comes in that you probably have heard before. It goes like this: for all sad words of tongue or pen, the saddest of these are "it might have been." How sad would it be for your life if that were said about you? Of all sad words of tongue or pen, the saddest of these are "it might have been." If they had might have just trusted Jesus, if they might have just followed the path that He had for them, things would have been different. Don't let that be said about you. Let it be said of you, this was a man or a woman or a teenager or a child who was willing to be a person of a different spirit, willing to stand up and say, if God gives me the vision, I will stand up and just do it. Just trust Jesus. Just follow Him faithfully in the path that I live in life. whatever it might be, would you be courageous enough to say, I'll be a man of a different spirit and I'll take a stand for Jesus? Let's pray together. Father, as you speak to our hearts, give us the courage to indeed be men and women and teenagers and children of a different spirit, where we will courageously step out in faith and follow you. Speak to our hearts, Lord Jesus, and show us if we need to take a step to follow you more faithfully. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing a hymn at this time, and if God has spoken to your heart and you need to respond, I'll be here at the front. You move if God speaks. Let's stand together.
Something in your heart today, in your life. And I hope that as you leave here today, you'll be able to say, it was a blessing to be in the house of the Lord today. Don't forget, I'll need a few people to help us out up here to clear this the stage and bring the risers out. And if you want to, come on back this afternoon at 4 o'clock and watch these four-year-olds put on their little caps and gowns and get ready to make their way to what they call big school. Okay? Let's have a word of prayer together and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for showing up today. Thank you for these encouraging words. And Father, I thank you that at one point in my life you encouraged me and I just did it. I just did it. And Father, I pray today that each of us that are here in this room today, Lord, that will not be afraid to just step out and do it. Guide us as we go to our homes today, Father. Keep us safe and in your arms. And Father, as we begin another week today, Lord, help us be salt and light in this world. Help us to encourage someone along the way. Help us to be Jesus to someone. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you for coming.
Jesus, take the beauty from the pain.
Jesus.